This is slime. Super fun to play with, and it has some cool things to teach us about science. In this video, we'll learn how to make it and why it works. We'll also talk about borax. What is it? Is it hazardous for our health or not? And can you make slime without it? Let's start with taking a closer look at glue. White school glue is PVA glue. That stands for polyvinyl acetate. If you look at the molecular structure, you'll find long chains of carbons, and every few carbons there's an oxygen, another carbon, and another oxygen. You see, PVA is what we call a polymer. Just like individual pearls strung together make a necklace, a few thousand pieces of vinyl acetate strung together make PVA. Besides these long strands of PVA, glue also has a lot of water. All that water allows the strands of PVA to slide past each other, kind of like a big bowl of wet spaghetti?
Huh?
But when the water evaporates, the glue hardens. The strands of PVA come together, attaching to each other and whatever else they're surrounding. There are a few other ingredients in the glue, but we don't know what they are.
What's in the glue?
Can't tell you.
Why not?
So that's glue. It sticks to the table and my fingers, and I can't gather it together and pick it up. It's a sticky liquid. If we add this sticky liquid to a solution of borax, it changes almost instantly. Now I can pick it up. It no longer sticks to my fingers. It's a stretchy, stiff substance. What happened? It was the borax. Borax is a salt called sodium tetraborate, and when it's added to glue, it bonds to the oxygens in the PVA, linking the long strands together. And when they're linked together, they behave very differently, and they don't flow past each other as well as they did before. If we saturate plain glue with borax, we get a very stiff substance, and it's so stiff it's hard to mold and stretch. And this is why, in our classic slime recipe, you add water to dilute the glue before you add the borax. In the classic slime recipe, you'll mix together one part glue with one part water and food coloring. And here, people sometimes make the mistake of not mixing the solution thoroughly. If you have some areas that are more concentrated with glue and others that are more watery, then your slime will end up having a very strange, uneven texture. So mix it thoroughly, and then you can do one of two things to activate it. Whichever method you use, you will need to make a borax solution, which is made with a ratio of 1 tablespoon of borax powder to 1 cup of water. Method one is to dump your glue mixture into the borax solution and then lift it out. After you lift it out, spend a minute or two kneading it together. The second way of activating the slime is to add 1 tablespoon of the borax solution and mix. Then add a second spoonful of the borax solution and mix again. After the second spoonful, you might be thinking that it's not working and won't come together and you'll need to add more borax, but don't add more borax yet or your slime might end up being too stiff. Take a minute or two to mix it and then test it with your fingers and see how tacky it is. Then, if you need to, sprinkle a little more solution over the slime. The texture of the finished slime is going to be pretty similar regardless of whether you use version 1 or version 2. And it's a fantastic substance. It stretches if you pull it slowly, but snaps apart if you pull it too fast. You can stretch it so thin that you can almost see through it, and it bounces. All of this begs the question, is slime a liquid or a solid? Well, it's a special kind of liquid called a non-Newtonian fluid. The more pressure you apply to it, the more it behaves like a solid. This is why when you drop it on a hard surface it bounces, or if you pull it fast it snaps. But it's still a fluid. It adopts the shape of its container, and if you leave it on a slope, it will slowly flow and ooze downhill. No doubt about it, slime is a ton of fun, and it's all made possible by the way borax links those polymers together. But is borax safe? Borax is sold in the laundry aisle of grocery stores without any safety warnings or restrictions. Table salt is also sold in grocery stores without any safety warnings or restrictions. And it's commonly used to make Play-Doh, which millions of children play with every year. Here's the deal. Toxicity depends entirely on the dose.
Too much of anything is too much.
Absolutely no table salt in a person's diet would be fatal. Fatal. Too much table salt in a person's diet would also be fatal. Yet, when used in the right amounts, table salt is perfectly safe and non-toxic. Borax is similar. The amount required to produce adverse reactions has been measured and it's quite high. Used in small amounts, it is very safe and non-toxic. So where did all the concern about borax being harmful come from? Near as I can tell, it happened in early 2017 when a young girl got severe blisters on her hands from prolonged exposure to slime. Articles ran headlines that borax posed potential health danger to kids, and borax-free slime recipes started popping up all over the internet. In this particular case, the girl spent several hours each day making and playing with slime. After several weeks, she developed a mild rash, continued to make slime, and then developed blisters.
Ah.
There are not many things that you should have consistent daily exposure to over a prolonged period of time. If you have sensitive skin, prolonged daily exposure to water can cause you to get severely chapped and irritated skin. And while there have been multiple documented cases of people having severe skin reactions to frequent hand washing or to bathing, we don't see a correlating response of concern about water safety. There has not been a wave of news headlines asking if it's safe to take a bath. Nor are we seeing a whole bunch of articles and tutorials for how to clean yourself with dust like a chicken. And it's worth pausing a minute and asking ourselves why. Why don't we blame water in this case? Some of the skin reactions that people have in response to daily bathing and hand washing are incredibly severe. But in these cases, we're quick to blame the circumstances or some unusual condition that the person has, not the substance. We don't rush to the assumption that water is dangerous. So why did we do that with borax? Well, maybe because water is necessary to our health and borax isn't. Perhaps because we have more evidence of bathing and hand washing being beneficial. But I think it's also due to a lack of understanding about chemistry, which is illustrated in the next recipe that we look at, the most popular borax-free slime recipe, contact solution slime. Mix one bottle of glue with a half tablespoon of baking soda and food coloring. Add one tablespoon of contact solution and voila, we have slime. How is this recipe working? Well, the baking soda increases the pH of our glue solution, and that causes more of the oxygens to react and to form polyvinyl alcohol and acetic acid. We're priming the pump so that when we add our borax activator, we won't need as much of it to get that same cross-linking to occur.
Now we can form cross-links even easier!
Hooray!
You might be thinking, wait a minute, contact solution doesn't have borax in it. Or does it? Look right here and you will see boric acid listed in the ingredients. For our intents and purposes, boric acid and borax are synonymous. They have virtually identical ratings in regards to safety and toxicity, and the salt, borax, converts very easily to its corresponding acid, boric acid. If there's enough boric acid in saline solution to activate slime, and millions of people use saline solution every day with no ill effects, then this is very strong evidence that boric acid and borax, when used appropriately and in small amounts, are incredibly safe and non-toxic. And the real question is, which slime is better? The classic slime made with the borax solution from the powder, or this newer recipe made with contact solution. I surveyed several kids, and they almost all agreed that they liked the contact solution slime best. It smells better, and it bounces and stretches a little more easily. The only thing that it didn't do as well as the classic slime was ooze. But we fixed that by making what I call Science Mom Slime. I tested dozens of recipes and finally came up with my own tweaked variation. This slime has the perfect balance of ooze, stretch, and bounce. 4 ounces of glue, 2 ounces of water, a half tablespoon of baking soda and food coloring, mix them together, then add your tablespoon of saline solution and mix. And you might need to add just a few drops more depending on how tacky your slime is. In my opinion, this slime has the perfect balance of ooze, stretch, and bounce.
The best slime ever!
But what if you want a slime that is even safer than the already safe borax-based or saline solution-based slimes? What if you want something that's not just non-toxic, but edible? There are a variety of glue-free, borax-free slime recipes out there, and while many of them will give you a slime-like substance in theory, in practice what often happens is that you either have a very sticky, oozy mess, or you get a dough. It's very difficult to land in between. But one of the more reliable glue-free recipes is to mix cornstarch with yogurt. If you experiment with the ratios here, you can often end up with something that is close to slime if you don't mind your fingers getting messy. Or if you add more cornstarch, you end up with a pretty cool dough. Let's take our edible slime that is actually more of a dough and compare it to our other three slime recipes. The borax and saline solution slimes all squelch very nicely. The yogurt cornstarch, not so much. Let's look at stretching and snapping. Windows. Bouncing. And oozing down a hole. Thanks for watching, and thank you to everyone who requested that I do a slime video. My own kids had a lot of fun helping me do this video. And if you would like to download a foldable book that has instructions for how to make each of the types of slime we made in this video, head over to my website. There's a link in the description down below. And you can also get some worksheets and coloring pages that talk a little bit more about non-Newtonian fluids and polymers and some of the cool science that goes along with slime. If you have other topics that you would like me to address in future videos, let me know in the comments. And as always, work hard, grow smart, and I'll see you next time. If you store your slime, you'll want to keep it in a covered container because it will dry out, just like the glue can dry out. And over time, it does get just a little bit more stiff and snappy. So there's our classic slime after a couple days. And here is saline solution. Without adding water, it still has nice stretch to it. Snap. And then here's the Science Mom slime. Still quite nice and oozy. Also hasn't changed too much after sitting for a day in a closed, sitting for a couple days in a closed container. Whoops.
Science Mom slime is the best. Oozes down perfectly. It comes off easily. Don't let it touch the ground. Dirt on the ground.